Well, welcome again, everyone. I'm Malcolm Bell. I'm the host for another in our series from our CV department of interviews with the experts. Recently, I was joined for this podcast by Dr. Stan Henkin, one of our vascular medicine specialists. And if you haven't listened to the podcast on dyspnea with after pulmonary embolism, I strongly recommend that you do. So we're pleased to have you back again today, Stan. And today we'll be talking about optimal medical therapy in peripheral arterial disease. So, this is you're welcome.
Thank you, Dr. Bell. It's a pleasure to be here again.
Okay. Well, we've got lots of clinicians listening to this, and they probably think they know what peripheral arterial disease is. But maybe you could just remind us in case there are any nuances that we're overlooking, and maybe just describe the most common symptoms that we may be on the lookout for in these patients. And I think the premise here is that this is a disease that is often overlooked, or people may feel uncomfortable with how to approach this. So, but maybe we'll just start off with those very simple questions.
Yeah, that's a very basic question, but it's a really important one because it's not well taught at all or well recognized. So what's peripheral artery disease? Well, peripheral artery disease is what it is and what it sounds like. It's atherosclerosis of peripheral arteries, meaning non-coronary arteries. Now, the actual difficulty with PAD is that unlike coronary artery disease, what it well describes that it's atherosclerosis of coronary artery, peripheral arteries, hard to know. Peripheral artery of what? Of the leg, of the arm, of the brain. So it mostly means when we think about peripheral artery disease, we mostly mean extremities, lower extremities, the limbs. And it affects up to 10 million individuals in the United States and probably underdiagnosed and really underrecognized. And the American Heart Association has really understood that it is well underrecognized and underreported and underdiagnosed and has a peripheral artery disease action plan where it involves the patients. And one of the steps is trying to have a better name for this. So be on the lookout for it. So that's really question number one. Question number two, so what are the symptoms? When we think again about coronary artery disease, we always ask about, do you have chest pressure? Do you have chest pain? Do you have shortness of breath? With peripheral artery disease of the limbs, it's more difficult. You know, we say, do your calves hurt when you're walking? And a lot of people say, no, my calves don't hurt, but I have pain in my hip. I have pain in my buttocks. And we think, nah, that doesn't sound like PAD. Well, actually, only a minority of patients present with classic intermittent claudication, where it's really pain in the calves when you're walking. The majority of patients, really two-thirds, present with other symptoms. It can be pain in the hips, pain in the thighs, pain in the buttocks. And it should be when you're walking, and it should stop when you stop. So don't just dismiss a patient when they say, no, my calves don't hurt, my hips do. And you say, oh, well, you have osteoporosis, you have osteoarthritis, that must be it. Really take the next step to figure out why is this happening?
Yeah, the classic situation where you sort of rush to make a diagnosis and then you sort of lock into that. But of course, you know, people with bad hips and backs, you know, their pain may get better when they stop walking or whatever. So,
yeah.
But if you are suspicious, or and obviously you're going to be feeling for the peripheral pulses and things. So the patient that you very clearly has claudication, or a patient that you described, it may not be so clear. How are you going to work that patient up? And maybe just before we get to medical treatment, which I think is really going to be the focus here, but can you just sort of just tell us, you know, the two or three steps that you may take to confirm that they do have peripheral arterial disease?
Yeah, this is really important. The first step is take off the shoes and the socks and feel the pulses. I mean, I know that we're limited on time with our patients. We have many patients to see throughout the day, but that's really the first step is do a thorough physical exam, feel those pulses. And not only the pedal pulses, but do a thorough physical exam, femoral pulses, popliteal pulses. And the more you do, the easier it is going to get, because I remember as a resident or fellow, I thought that a 30-year-old had peripheral artery disease because I could not feel those pulses. But the more you do, the better you're going to get. Then the next step is really the diagnostic test of choice is ankle brachial index. And a resting ankle brachial index is the first step where you measure pressure in the arm. You compare it to pressure in the leg. Pressure in the leg should be higher than the pressure in the arm because of gravity. But if it's lower, usually less than 0.9 is the ratio, that's diagnostic of peripheral artery disease. The step even further to consider is to do an exercise ankle brachial index if you're suspicious, but the resting ankle brachial index is normal. It's, again, very similar to stress testing in coronary artery disease. You get a resting echo, it's normal. You get a stress echo, it's abnormal. The idea is exactly the same. You get rest ABI, it's normal. Patient exercises, they get pain, they stop. You get a post-exercise ankle brachial index, it's 0.6 or 0.7. There, you have unmasked ankle brachial index.
And at that point, are you ready for medical therapy, or do you need to do any imaging studies at this point, whether it's ultrasound or CT?
At this point, you are ready to do the medical therapy. You really don't need to consider any other imaging at this point because you have diagnosed peripheral artery disease. This is probably stable peripheral artery disease. And unless you're considering intervention, you really don't need any further imaging because it's not going to help you.
Okay. So tell us about the therapies. Is it all pharmacotherapy, or what other options do we have?
Yeah, pharmacotherapy is certainly an important aspect of it, but non-pharmacotherapy interventions are really important. So I divided really lifestyle interventions and pharmacotherapy. When we're thinking about lifestyle interventions, the most important thing that you can do is spend time on nicotine cessation. Nicotine cessation, nicotine cessation, nicotine cessation, because this really increases the risk of proximal peripheral artery disease, aorta-iliac peripheral artery disease, where the classic symptoms is buttock claudication. Patients may have erectile dysfunction. So cutting down on that smoking cessation and then fully quitting is super important. Spend time on that. The next step is diet. And you'll say, well, why? Well, because we know that Mediterranean diet decreases the risk of adverse cardiovascular events. And it's the same thing with peripheral artery disease. Talk about Mediterranean diet, have a handout on it. That's really important to decrease risk of adverse cardiac and limb events as well. The next step is pharmacotherapy. And I divide pharmacotherapy into buckets as well. There is antiplatelet therapy, there is statin therapy, and then there is diabetic therapy. And then finally, the very last bucket, but probably the most important one for the patient, is symptoms. What are we going to do about those symptoms? And that's probably the hardest aspect of this. But you need to talk about all those things during your visit with the patient.
So there's a lot to uncover there. And maybe just sort of staying on the pharmacologic approach here, you mentioned antiplatelet agents. So patient with mild claudication, what antiplatelet agent are you going to recommend?
Yeah, this is a really excellent question and probably the hardest one. So classically, we have thought of aspirin as the best antiplatelet agent for peripheral artery disease. But I would like us to think about the CAPRI trial, actually. And the CAPRI trial compared aspirin and compared to clopidogrel, and actually found that in those individuals who were taking clopidogrel, the risk of major adverse cardiac and limb events was actually lower than aspirin, while the risk of bleeding was similar between aspirin and clopidogrel.
That's such an important thing to emphasize, isn't it? Everyone thinks that clopidogrel causes more bleeding than aspirin, and the number of trials that really show that it's not. And you're talking about this trial, but this is a trial that's more than 20 years old, as I recall. 20,000 patients, you're double-blind.
I totally agree, and we do this all the time. And even recently, as you very well know, aspirin has gotten such a bad rep. There were New York Times articles about, stop your aspirin. Nobody needs an aspirin anymore. And we have to really talk to our patients about, gosh, this is not the case for you. You're in a different bucket than a patient who doesn't need aspirin. But I think that the biggest two things that I do during my visit is talk about antiplatelet therapy. And if the patient truly is at a lower risk of bleeding, and I talk to them about, look, clopidogrel probably has the same risk of bleeding and probably even lower than aspirin, I switch it. That's step number one. And again, be comfortable with clopidogrel. We know how to deal with clopidogrel. We know how to deal with bleeding with clopidogrel. So make sure to get your patients on the right antiplatelet therapy.
And then statins, are we doing the same thing as we do for heart disease? I mean, this is high potency, high dose statins, LDL goals, same?
Yeah, that's another really excellent question. And the next most common thing that I do during our visit. So when we think about statin goals, I really think about two things. I think about LDL goal, which LDL goal is less than 55 milligrams per deciliter as somebody with PAD. But the other goal is 50% or more reduction in your LDL. So the most common thing I see is somebody whose LDL may be 90 on no therapy, and they're started on a moderate intensity statin, such as pravastatin or maybe simvastatin, and their LDL is now 70, and they're told, that's great, you're a goal. That's absolutely not true. We need to get these individuals on high potency statins, such as atorvastatin 40 or 80, rosuvastatin 20 or 40, and we need to reach that goal of less than 55 milligrams per deciliter plus 50% reduction LDL. So one is not enough. You need to have both.
I'm sort of trying not to smile here because, then we ran into the statin intolerance. And where do they get that discomfort? Oh, and in their lower extremity muscles and things. So that I'm sure you have a way of dealing with that. But let's move on. And so how are you going to follow this patient? You know, so you started these therapies. I'm not sure we've already talked about sort of exercise program yet.
Yeah, and this is what patients care about most. They care about their symptoms. You know, they care a lot less about what medications do I need to take. They want to feel better. You know, a lot of times we see individuals who are working. They need to walk for their job, and they're saying, I have to stop because my legs hurt when I walk. So there's two important components to improving symptoms. One is, shockingly, pharmacotherapy. The other one is lifestyle intervention. Over the last 20 years, there's been a lot of research done on supervised exercise therapy. Now, this is similar to cardiac rehab, but specifically focused on symptoms for the legs. And in 2010s, we as a cardiology community, got Medicare approval for payments for supervised exercise therapy. And this is really, really important because not many individuals know about this. But majority of hospitals do actually have these programs set up. So step number one is refer your patient to supervised exercise therapy. This is a therapy where patients walk on a treadmill, they're monitored by nurses, they get similar type of education. And we know that with that, pain-free walking time improves and total walking time improves. Now, the important aspect that I will mention for this is ankle brachial index will probably not get better. But this is that ischemic conditioning that we so often talk about in myocardial disease. The same happens in the periphery. You get improved oxygen delivery. You get probably some collaterals there as well. And it's still so unfortunately underused. I mean, there's been, in the last 10 years, the uptake is horrible. It's like 5%. I mean, we can do better as a community. And so that's really step number one.
In terms of follow-up, and in particular, maybe we should just think about this point, when do they need to see a vascular specialist? And in particular, when should we be considering some sort of intervention?
Yeah.
Aggressive intervention.
I think seeing a vascular specialist is okay at any time. Yeah, you know, patient has claudication diagnosed with peripheral artery disease. I think it is okay to refer to a vascular specialist at any time because, again, we can have nuanced conversations about antiplatelet therapy, statin therapy, or lipid therapy in general, because we talk that statin intolerance is so common. So this is when we think about additional agents like ezetimibe, PCSK9 inhibitors, now bempedoic acid, and other therapies. And then when do we think about intervention? You know, so the good news, and that's a really important conversation that I have with the patients, is that I tell them that their risk of having chronic limb-threatening ischemia or amputation because of their peripheral artery disease is extremely low. It's less than 5%. That's what people care about. Am I going to lose my leg? Am I going to lose my toes? And the risk of that is extremely low. What do we do to make it even lower? Pharmacotherapy, lifestyle interventions. But how do I follow these patients? I see them on a regular basis. The first time I see them back is 3 months. I get repeat lipid panel and I talk to them. And how are you doing? And then the next step in terms of when do I need intervention, it's really, how are your symptoms doing? If they say, look, I've tried everything and I still can't do what I need to do. I can't play with my grandkids. I can't work because my legs hurt so much. This is when we start considering intervention because quality of life is really important. And if we've done everything that we need to and we can do for these patients, by the way, including smoking cessation. Smoking cessation is truly paramount before considering intervention. for these patients. Because just like in stable chronic coronary artery disease, the same is true for stable ischemic peripheral artery disease. This is elective. This is for symptoms. This is not to improve major adverse cardiac events or limb events. We need to do everything we need so that this doesn't happen again.
Well, it's very encouraging to hear that, you know, at least with good medical treatment and exercise program, that the risk of having a major complication is relatively low. Stan, I'd love to get you back again. We can go to the next phase to discuss that in terms of, you know, who needs intervention and what type of interventions we would be considering. So again, I want to thank you for being with us today and sharing your expertise and experience in this incredibly important disease. And again, as we said at the beginning, sort of maybe sort of undertreated and underdiagnosed. And again, I thank our viewers and listeners for joining us today.